thank you very much to all for attending this talk. I know there is intense competition, everyone competing for bodies, but I'm glad that we can look at how technology is transforming the world and especially transforming nation states. And it is really my great pleasure. I mean, every speaker says this, it's, you know, pleasure to be here and so on, but it is really my pleasure to be here today. And I tell you what I find so exciting about an event like this. It's with close to 1,000 students and young people who are going to be the decision makers of tomorrow in business, in the arts, in science, in, you know, media. And it's really like witnessing history in the making, the future as it is emerging. And actually, because the organizers very kindly invited me, I'm even more thrilled because it means that I am participating in the future that is emerging. It is flattering. I would like to take you back to January of 1919, 2 months only after the end of the First World War. And that is when the German sociologist Max Weber gave a talk, and he gave a talk in Munich with the title Politics as... Politics as Vocation. And in that talk... In that talk, he gave a definition of the state. A definition of a state that has become canonical. I mean, you find it in every textbook. It is the one that we live with today. And the definition in English translation reads like this. A state is a human community that successfully claims the monopoly of legitimate violence, use of force over a given territory. Now, the absolute conclusion, the absolute outcome of this definition is Ein Reich, Ein Volk, and Führer. A country, a people, and a government. Note the elements in that definition. The state is a human community. In other words, it is not an abstraction. It is not something that exists out there in the ether. A state is a community of people who are the civil servants, who are the military, who are the police, who are all the state employees. And these people have their own interest. They have their own aspirations. They have their own goals in life. They form this community, which is different from the rest of us. And that's why they need to use physical force. Because if their interests were exactly coinciding with the common good, in other words, with the interests of all of us, then we would all understand what we should be doing, what we ought to be doing. And therefore, there would be no need for physical violence. There would be no need for the use of force. It will be simply the state, maybe the community of these people, telling us, we advise you to do this. We recommend that you do this. It would be in your interest to do this. And we would do it. But the fact that there is that chasm, that there is this community which doesn't have the same interest as we have, means that the use of force is necessary. By the way, if you are a Marxist and you believe in class struggle, that is the class struggle of today between state employees and producers. It is state employees who are extracting surplus value by producers with the use of physical force. If that is not exploitation of men by men, then what is? Now, the other element in that definition is a given territory. A territory. Now, do you realize that we live in a world where people are using Skype? People are using cheap travel. They are traveling all over. They are marrying or having partners or having friends from all over the world. Internet, globalization. What is the relevance of territory in today's world? Note that states, actually, do not protect populations. States were formed at the time of the Neolithic Age to protect the land. That was the source of wealth, not the people, the land. It was to protect the land against invaders, against marauders. That's why you had an army. The population, they were sent to fight. They were sent to kill or be killed. They were sent to die for king and country. They were not the ones to be protected. The land, the country, was the one to be protected. Now, the people today who believe that land is wealth and that therefore you have a necessity to fight for your country are the people whose flags, who are brandishing the flags that you have just seen. They are the people who believe in nation, who believe that we should protect something that is our collective culture, our collective language, all these things that our ancestors have died for. They want to protect cemeteries. Now, why? If a culture, and I'm passionate about French culture, I'm passionate about French language, but if a culture needs police and armies to be protected, and not simply the ones who are using this culture, what is the value of this culture? Whom is it worth for? So you can see that there was something else at work when nation states emerged in the 18th century. They are recent creation, they are only 200 years old. And they were coming into play because the old division in society between aristocracy and commoners, between feudal lords and serfs, that old division was cracking down with the French Revolution in 1789. And there needed to be something else to hold the country together, to prevent civil wars, to prevent revolutions. The people in the state, that community, needed something, a new ideology, in order to remain in power. And they found that new ideology in the nation states. We are one nation. United we stand. El pueblo unido jamás será vencido. United we need to be. L'union fait la force. We are in the same boat. Why are you against me? We are all French, right? We are all British. We are all the people who fight the guys on the other side of the border. You are Germans, you hate the French, right? That was the idea. It suppresses division within society. And therefore, that community that is the state can ask you sacrifices. Go and die for the country. Pay your taxes. Obey the laws, however stupid they are. Bow. Genuflect, because we are the nation and you are part of it, and we have to follow the rules of the nation or it will disintegrate. We will be invaded by Martians, by little green men. Even the Bolsheviks, in 1941, in order to save the country, had to go back to all what they believed before, internationalism, socialism in every country, and so on. And they said, this is the great patriotic war. Historically, states played a part. They had a reason in the evolution of humanity. They had a reason to exist, because in a way they did pacify the land. They did pacify some populations and so on. And where states do not exist today, in Somalia, in Libya, it's easy to point at the resurgence of warlords, at the resurgence of the war of all against all, a Hobbesian world. But that exists only in Libya, in Somalia. Humanity has evolved. And in the world today, people who are clinging on to the states, who are saying, this is the only way to ensure security, to ensure safety, to protect us, they are forgetting the inexorable march of technology, which is pointing us to another world. They are like King Canute, you know, that mythological king of old England and so on, who believed that he could stop the tide coming in by beating the waves. You know what happened. And today, you have King Canutes, you have politicians on the left and the right of the political spectrum. In France, for instance, hard right and hard left are all committed against globalization, against modernity, against a bigger world, a world more with opportunities for more people everywhere, in Africa, in China, and elsewhere. You have Putin in Russia, you have people in Hungary, you have people in Poland, you have people in Britain. In Britain, you have the left and the right, who are both looking at the past, at this past of the 1950s, when technology was moving slowly and it could be controlled, when people could form a circle around their country, a rampart around their country, in order to stop imports of goods and in order to keep the foreigners out there. That is a world that both the political left and the political right are turning to, harking back to. That is the world of Donald Trump. Trump says, let's make America great again. You should be saying, let's make America greater than she's ever been, if he was someone of the future. But he is definitely someone from the past. And the future needs to be greater than our past, greater than the present. Look at what is happening today. Energies, creativity of millions of people, not allowed to flourish because we have criminal governments, because we have people who are battling this movement, this historical movement, driven by technology as it always is, that is bringing us to another world. And it is the old Marx model. Change in technologies bring about change in production, in modes of production, and necessarily it brings about changes in political structures. That is how it has been since the beginning of history, since the Neolithic age. Hegel used to say, men make history, but they don't know the history that they are making. And of course, they do not know. Of course we do not know. Because there is something that is flowing through us, something working through us. Religions call it God, divine providence. The Chinese say this is the way of the Tao. Adam Smith calls it the invisible hand. And why not simply call it life? Life, in that sense, life has more imagination than we have. Life takes us to places that we would never have explored if we had wanted to plan the journey. The mission, the libertarian mission in this world, your mission, is to facilitate that journey, identify the hurdles, the roadblocks put on the way by the old regime, and show people that these hurdles can be removed and life can flow and be easier and be more beautiful. Libertarian can show that technology and the freedom it brings is not to be feared. But the brains of Neolithic man are wired to reject change. Remember that for thousands of generations, our ancestors lived in the savannah, small tribes, 40 to 100 individuals, no capital, lived hand to mouth. So when the tribe understood and learned what were the fruits and plants that were edible, what were the predators to be feared, and how to fight them, how to live securely, where to find water, when they had understood all this, then they didn't want any change. Change would have been too dangerous. So what you did is that you followed the elders. The elders taught the young people. Today it's the reverse. It's young people who are teaching young generation, older generation, how to handle all this technology. But for so long, it had been the other way around. You followed tradition with a capital T. So it's a huge revolution, not only in the world outside, but in our minds. And it's difficult to let go. It's difficult to trust. It's difficult to trust that life is taking you to better places if you don't try to fight it. Now, because Neolithic man is incapable of conceiving a new world, it hangs on to the model of the past. And when there is globalization, what they do is say, okay, we want that Max Weber definition of a state. But because of globalization, the country should be the whole planet. We want a world government. And of course, when you mention world government to libertarians, they brandish garlic and crucifixes. That is the devil. They are right. They are right. But then many minarchists go the other way around. They say, well, we don't want to scale up the model. We want to bring it down to the Middle Ages, to the small communities of the past. We want to have this, little Europes, all little sort of countries and so on, where you can move from one government to another if your government is oppressive. That is a model that Niall Ferguson, the conservative historian, is saying. You know, this is what made Europe the leader in technology, philosophy, and so on, because people were reproved, people were ostracized, people were banned, were censored under one government, they went to another. It's a sad joke in the world today to think that people who would be oppressed in one country could move to another. You don't think that. But just to remind you that there are millions of people today who are oppressed by their government. And what we do is that we keep them out. So if you believe that all these little principalities will allow you to move when you don't like your government, I think you are taking an immense risk, because the experience of today shows us that that model does not work. Governments are governments. Whether they are ruling big countries, whether they are ruling small countries. The problem is not the size of a country. The problem is the government. It is what, it's their nature. It is what Max Weber was saying. It is that they have a monopoly of violence. They can exert physical force and coercion against innocent with impunity. Do we want to give impunity to violent people? Is it logical? Does it make sense? Is it moral? No. But there are certain things that governments do that are legitimate functions. Look at these functions. There we are. These functions, protection agencies, of course, they are bad guys. We don't want them in government, where they tend to congregate. But they exist. They exist. We want a police. We want a justice system that works. We want standards and industry, otherwise the internet wouldn't work. We want all these things that can be provided by other actors than governments globally, whether it's for profit or whether it's simply association that is not seeking a profit. We want currencies that are global. All this idea of the Middle Ages, with each little dukedom, principality, bishopry, and so on, having its own currency, does it make sense? Imagine the world of today. You have to pay wherever you go. You have 3-4 credit cards. MasterCard, Visa, American Express, I can't even quote a fourth one. That's, if a market was there, you would have all these national currencies that would disappear, which are only tools of government in order to expropriate you. And you would have 2, 3, 4 global currencies. And you would have very small local currencies as well. Because all that, many of these things, not all of them, but many of these things that work at the global level, they are also needed at the very local level. Police needs to be global because unless you have you are living under a rock somewhere, you have noticed that criminality is global, terrorism is global. Gangs can be across borders, of course they are. And many other things, pandemics. So you need to have these global structures. But at the same time, criminality is very local. The bicycle thief, these people, you know, burglars, things like that. So you want to have various levels of intervention, which governments do not allow, because governments want to retain, of course, their police, their army, all these, you know, criminal courts, all these sort of things, because that is the instrument of their power. But if you want to have a functioning society, a society where what you pay gives you the service that you are paying for, then you need to have structures that are very close to you, that you can negotiate directly with the people who are rendering the service and so on, and you want at the same time to have a very global structure. You have a situation where these agencies, global and local, are there to protect you. They are not there to protect the land. They are not there to protect the country. They are there to protect you. You are paying them and you want them to give you the service that you require. I leave certain things to a Q&A. But I would like to mention this. For a very long time, our ancestors believed that spirits and deities ruled nature. And if you perform the correct rituals, the harvest would be abundant. Children would be cured of their illnesses. For a very long time, our ancestors owned slaves, or were slaves themselves. Aristotle, the great Aristotle, believed that slavery was natural. And for a very long time, Our ancestors believed that men were to work in the fields, like oxen, and women were to produce babies and feed them, like cows. Our ancestors believed that the king was a representative of God on earth. That is what we have been told for centuries and centuries. I think that the nation state is what we have been told, and it is on the way out. We are no longer living in the Neolithic age. So, thank you.
Countries, would people be able to defend themselves with like guns, for example, with an ammunition?
Well, I think that there are always borders. My skin and your skin are borders. They define what is our body. Private property is a form of border. And you have neighborhoods, you have, you know, all sorts of things. It doesn't need to be a state. It's only the extent of your possibilities. My skin is the extent of the possibility that my body can reach out. And my property is the extent of what I can do in that space, and so on. States are simply there to confiscate borders, to say that actually there isn't a border that you should use in order to protect you from the bullets of the Germans. I'm French. So so in other words, the function of the states is to say, look, there is no private border. There is just the border of a state. And within those borders, I can tell you what to do with your property. Is that the answer you expected? Yeah, I think that is okay.
So you support the world government, for example? You don't support the world government?
I'm certainly not in favor of world government, no. Because I'm not in favor of government, whether it's world or small or big or medium. So, yeah.
Yeah. Would you maybe see it as a pathway? A lot of small governments to maybe the non-government at all, because there would be more competition, because you have a lot of states, and so there are more examples in general, and then there are more good examples, and everybody can see that this is what works, so there is more competition, and then everything, and then progressively a lot more stuff will be privatized, so until the basic functions of government will be privatized.
Well, that is a bizarre way of reasoning. In other words, what it says is that, well, I don't like governments and we should have more of them. So, no, I think that the smaller the government, the more legitimacy it has. Because the more it can get into the heads of people. And that is what, you know, probably the one good thing about the European Union is that everybody could hate it. So, whereas if you have your own government, in other words, you can say, oh, you know, this is our British government, this is our Queen, this is, you know, the government that we fought two world wars for, we fought Napoleon for, and so on. So I think there is a big danger there. And I think this idea that, you know, minarchists have, let's have not only small governments, but lots of governments, is a terrible trap for the future of freedom. Because, and I mentioned this, you are not going to move to another country. Look at what's happening. You know, the French are trying to keep Polish plumbers out. British are trying to expel all the foreigners. You have that reaction if you have a small government, you have a reaction that it is even more so my government. And you, it is one of the things that I have against universal income. Universal income is not only a problem because it raises taxes and things like that, but because it encourages the idea that if I'm French, I can go and live in France and I will be paid. And people there, they can't do this. They stay in Haiti. So the big danger there is to reinforce what is the legitimacy of governments, nation states. It's together. If there is a state, there is a nation. The more nation there is, the more state there will be. Because that state will have legitimacy. It can impose things on you. Because it's for the good of France, for the good of Britain, for the good of Czech Republic. Yes.
Well, first of all, I would like to thank you for being elected. And well, you were the logic and everything, as far as I understood, is based that social like the social contract was based basically in the security that people would have. I don't know if I'm going to be alive tomorrow, therefore I just like merge and create like something that would protect me. That's how Hobbes pointed it out. So there's like various actors taking charge of this security. Obviously, the state is because it's pointless to have it. But since nations are based on the idea of us versus those who are not us, to basically abolish the nation or just try to create a future nationless, I think this is a really hard task because if you just focus on local threats, it can happen. Actually, I would like to see it happen. But if you think of, let's say, the global level and macro level, you have like global threats that just have this us, them, always there. So what would be like kind of a solution or a path to follow in order to just like go and fight against these global threats without just coming back to this us, them, but already?
Well, there is, of course, there are always threats. We are not going to move to a sort of utopia where everybody will be good, kind, gentle, and so on. But if you think of a term nation, it has a Latin etymology, a root, being born, nativity. And what it defines is people by how they were born, where they were born, from whom. In other words, it's fate. It is something that you don't control. You happen to have been born French, British, Chinese. What the difference between us and them can be is values. In this room, you know, a guess, there are probably 10 different nationalities. In this building today, right now, we are attending a conference with probably 30, 40 nationalities, maybe more. What gets us together? Values. We believe in certain ideals. We are not concerned where the people are born, where born. We are not concerned what passport they carry. We are concerned that they have certain aspirations, certain ideals, certain virtues, and we share them. And isn't that a lot more inspiring than simply being part of a group because you took the trouble of being born in the right place? And you would exclude those people because they had the misfortune of being born in a poor country, in a totalitarian, under a totalitarian regime, and so on. They are not us. No. I think the people who are not us are the people who don't want to live like us. And that's fine. I mean, when I was in Russia in, you know, the 1980s, 90s, I would find these old Soviets who were saying, in the Cold War, capitalism has won and we lost. And I said, guys, there was never a war between socialism and capitalism. Under the most capitalist society, all the people who want to share equally their income, to give away their means of production and give up their inheritance. Pajausta. I mean, they are free to do it. And if all the people in the world who believe that, you know, and saw that these people who shared equally their income and so on, they were happy and doing very well, communism would have, you know, collected everybody, and everybody would be communist without violence. The fact is that people don't like the lifestyle of a communist. Very few people do. And therefore, they had to impose violence in order to get, you know, the regime they wanted. So the war was not between capitalism and communism. The war was between capitalism and imposed communism. Because communists didn't allow people to be capitalists. Whereas capitalists are perfectly happy with people who want to be communists, provided they don't impose their communism on others. That is the difference. Not where you are born, not your genes, not the things that you cannot control, but the things that you do want for yourself, the virtues that you want to put in practice, the values that you uphold. That is what makes a community, a small community, a big community. And people who want to join that community, let's welcome them. And people who don't want to be part of that community but are peaceful, let them form another community, whenever it is, big or small. Well, are we going to stop here, or?
Yeah. You use the concept of class struggle. I know it was a libertarian, liberal, classical liberal concept, not a socialist concept. But I have a problem with that when we use it, because I find that I think we have to take also in account the Bastia definition of the state, is that everyone wants to have his part of it. And it's what I see in the structure of the states right now. Everyone have the parts and they benefit a little bit and they want to have more from that. So what you think about the use of this concept of class struggle right now? Is that a good concept that we have to use or not?
Well, who is we? I mean, I use it because I think it is, you know, informative. It tells something, makes people understand things. But, you know, I'm fine if you don't want to use it. I think it's an interesting concept because it is, and I've written about this, and Hans Hermann Hoppe, I know, is a bit provocative and so on, but he has written about this as well. And I think the idea is simply to view the state not as an abstraction, but really, as Max Weber taught us, to view the state as people, individuals. And individuals who are there because they can use legitimate violence in order to extract income from all of us. So they are an exploiting class. They function like a class, especially in a country like France. You know, we are both French. In a country like France, where there is class solidarity between state employees. So they you know, go on strike, they have all these attitudes, all these behavior of a class. And they have an ideology. And the ideology is exactly this. The ideology is, look, without us, the state couldn't function. People would die in the street because there would be no hospital. People would, be robbed, blind, because there would be no police. It is exactly the idea that people had in their minds in the 17th century. If we didn't have a king, what would happen? It would be terrible. If it's exactly what you had in, you know, the century before, in the 16th century, if we were not all Catholic, or if we were not all Protestant, we couldn't function. We see that we function without kings. We function without, you know, being religious and so on. It is something that we have in our heads, that we need the state. We need this class of people who exploits us in order to function. We are willing, exploited when we don't need to be. And this is exactly what libertarians can do as the avant-garde, to continue on the Marxist sort of language, the avant-garde of a world that is emerging. It is to say, we can teach people that they can become aware of their exploitation. They can become aware that the state is not only useless, it is actually lethal. So our mission in life is that. Teach, preach, make people aware that they don't need exploitation in order to survive as a society. There can be, there should be, a society where exploitation doesn't exist, where physical violence is not legitimate ever.